Any of you who've ever had a baby and had to look after it, or caretaken, have to caretaken someone else's baby, or have had a puppy or a kitten or a fledgling bird that you were looking after, you know what it's like, right? You pay attention to it. You listen to the signal. So first of all, neither a baby nor a puppy or a kitten or a fledgling bird can actually speak. So you don't actually know what they need. And because you don't know what they need, and because you can't, you have to interpret the signals, you're very sensitive to whatever signals they're giving you. So if we use a baby, when it cries, I don't know, maybe the first thing you do is you check its nappy and see if it needs to have its nappy changed. And then if its nappy's changed and it's still uncomfortable, then maybe it's hungry. So then you feed it. And then if it's still uncomfortable, well, maybe it needs to be burped. So you burp it. And then maybe it just needs to be cuddled and it needs to be soothed. So you hold it. Or it's awake and it wants to be amused. So you play with it. But you are attentive to it. You put your awareness on it. And when you do that, babies, when they get their basic needs met, where they're clean and they eat, have eaten, and they then also get loved and they get cared for and they get attention, then they thrive. They thrive and grow. So why do we, when we're trying to get healthy or trying to lose weight, instead of adopting this nourishing approach of paying attention to our signals, giving ourselves what we need as if we were a baby, if one thing doesn't work, then doing something else. There's no point in feeding a baby when it's got a dirty nappy. It's still going to cry. Well, it might stop crying for a little bit, but then it's going to cry again. Or feeding it when it's not hungry. It doesn't want the bottle. Or changing its nappy when it's actually starving and really just wants food. So why do we do that when we're trying to get healthy, or when we're trying to lose weight, for example? When I say why do we do that, why do we feed ourselves when we're not hungry? Feed ourselves stuff we don't want to eat. Eat at times that we potentially don't want to eat. Starve ourselves at times when we do want to eat. Punish ourselves by exercising really hard because of what we ate. Or punishing ourselves by exercising harder than what our current fitness level is actually comfortable with, so that we can't move for 4 days after that. So we do the exact opposite thing that we do to children and pets to make them thrive. We do the exact opposite thing to ourselves when we're trying to make ourselves have more energy, have more health, be more vital, be more alive, and thrive. It's fucked up, yo, as my daughter would say. It's stupid. So for those of you who have started this new year with an idea that you were going to get your health on track, and maybe you've been really good about it, and maybe you really have been hitting the road, and maybe you've been doing the exercise, and maybe you're actually feeling magnificent. And quite frankly, if you are, I salute you. Well done. And I'm not knocking it. What I'm worried about, though, is where are you going to be in 2 or 3 months' time? Now, I know right now when you're riding the crest of, okay, I'm starting to see results and I'm starting to feel okay, you're going to tell me that in 3 months' time you are going to be rocking it, and that in 12 months' time you're going to be rocking it even more. But experience has shown me, not only with myself, but with patients in more than 20 years of private practice, that whole I'm rocking it lasts for 3 months, maybe 6 months, and then at some point the wheels fall off. And I believe that part of the reason why that happens is because you can't use a system that is punishing in order to actually help someone thrive. So, and listen, I've done this to myself my whole life. That's why I'm so passionate about teaching this now. I've done this to patients. I've just said to them, look, you feel like crap. You need to stop eating this shit. You need to start doing X, Y, and Z. And if you don't, tough ski for you. That used to be my attitude. It was like, take it or leave it, you know? If you wanted like good bedside manner, then I was probably not the person to come and see. If you wanted boot camp, I was your girl. And it did actually work. And it worked in the short term. But the thing is, it didn't work in the long term. And it didn't work for me either. So I think that there's a better way that we can reach health and vitality. I think we can do that by nourishing ourselves. But there's always a price that you have to pay. So in order for that baby to thrive, it needs attention. And it's easier for us to just follow a diet plan or follow a coach or do what we're told or go through the motions or do the training program or listen to the app, because then the app, the coach, the nutrition program, that has the power. It takes the responsibility, and your responsibility is to do it. And that's hard. I'm not knocking that. It's hard. But if you decide to nourish yourself to health and vitality, then you have to pay attention. You have to start treating yourself as if you were that baby. And you know why? Because you don't understand the language, actually. Because many of us don't even know what real physical hunger feels like. Many of us don't know when we've had enough. Many of us don't know when we're thirsty, because we've become so deaf to the signals from our body, because we don't pay attention, because our attention is out there. It's so in the world. And I mean, it's so easy to have your attention out there because we get distracted by so many things and we're so busy. So the fact of the matter is that unless you actually turn your attention inwards, or, you know, when you are on, if you're on your phone and the baby's crying, well, hello, you don't know what it needs. You need to actually be with it. You need to be checking it. So it's not that you can't be on your phone, right? Of course you can be on your phone, but you need to have awareness. You need to pay attention. And that's the part that's hard, I think, about nourishing yourself. Because A, you don't generally get really quick results, because this is a pattern that you've had a whole lifetime that you have to undo. B, you want quick results. I want to be thin and rich last week. Not much to ask, right? Well, I'm neither thin nor rich. So, hello. But here's the thing. You can get quick results with one of those punishing regimens, which is what we've all done. You know, we've all lost the same 10 kilos 1,000 times. I'm speaking to those of us who have disordered eating. Or disordered health. It might not be eating necessarily, just disordered health essentially. And so what ends up happening is we have short-term results. We feel amazing. We swear, vow and declare we're never going to go back there again. And then ultimately we do. And the reason why that happens is because you can't have lasting results if you're using an outside-in approach to trying to get healthy. You have to, you not have to, you have a choice. An alternative strategy that may benefit you is to have an inside-out approach. Because once you've actually altered it on the inside, once you've changed those habits, then the external form has to follow. And the benefits of doing that is that you connect to yourself. You start listening to your own signals. You start becoming more sensitive to your signals. And when you do that, you become more connected to yourself. And when you become more connected to yourself, you're more likely to embrace your not so amazing bits as well as your more than amazing bits. And then you start recognizing that in other people. And if you can love yourself despite, and I mean such a trite, you know, you gotta love yourself, but if you can accept yourself because of your seemingly negative characteristics and you can own your awesomeness, then it becomes easier to love other people because of their seemingly negative characteristics and their awesomeness. And then you start being able to engage with your life more fully. So I prefer to adopt a new strategy. And that strategy is to nourish myself to good health. I'm not punishing anymore. And any action can be either nourishing or punishing. So I can go to my karate class tomorrow night at the end of a long day at work and I'll be tired, but I'm not going to exercise in the morning. And it could be punishing. If I'm feeling sick and I have a raging headache, that's punishing. But you know what? If I'm just tired after a long day at work and I go and I reconnect to people that I haven't seen since last year and we stretch and we start working out and we start sweating together. Oh, those karate gis in the hot dojo in the middle of summer. I always feel better afterwards. So that's an act of nourishment, right? Because in actual fact, I'm nourishing myself on many levels, not just physically. Whereas if I drag myself out of bed and I drag myself onto that run because I ate the chocolate yesterday, that's punishment. That's not running because I actually want to move my body. That's running because I'm punishing myself because I feel ashamed and guilty because I was such an undisciplined whatever and I ate a slab of chocolate yesterday. So it's not about what action you take. You could be on the most amazing weight loss diet. You could be on the most amazing anti-inflammatory program. I still put my patients on those. But what I do know is that unless you actually are doing it in a from a mindset of nurture, it's just going to be punishing. And when you continuously punish children, they don't thrive. They don't engage fully with life. So I would encourage you to consider a different strategy. If you're interested in a different strategy, then click on the link below or above this video and you'll find some more information on my Ditch Diets for Good program. And I'd love for you to join me.